afternoon, South Africa. Welcome to Afternoon Express. It's Friday, so we're ready to whisk you away into the weekend with the fun-filled program today.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for joining us. We are on SABC3. I'm Bonang Matiba. Like Bonnie said, it is a Friday, and today we are celebrating legends, legends of dance, legends of music, and legends of sport.
Yeah, first of all, we take a look at the life of King of Rock and Roll, Elvis Presley, through the eyes of ballet choreographer Sean Bovim, who also has brought along a performance for us.
That is going to be very, very exciting. Very excited about that. I love Elvis Presley as well. A little bit later, right here in the loft, we're going to be taking a closer look at It's a Kind of Magic, which is a very epic tribute show to the iconic rock band Queen. We also have Freddie Mercury's former PA and close friend, Peter Freestone. He's going to be in the loft. I'm dying to ask him all those very important questions.
Yeah, and visiting us in the loft today are some young ladies who are taking part in South Africa's first ever 50s retro pinup pageant. Can you believe it? Yeah. So if you love the 50s, you don't want to miss this.
And that's not enough. We also went all the way to Sun City. Well, Danilo did. We were left right here in the lot. And he caught up with former South African golfing legend, Gary Player, who of course celebrated his 80th birthday this month. But so much to do, so little time. It's not just me and Bon Bizzle in the lot. Jeannie Dizzle is in the kitchen. Check it out.
Thanks, B Squared, and welcome to Afternoon Express. I'm Jeannie D. Now, if there wasn't enough happening in the loft today, get a load of all of this that we're cooking in the kitchen with, of course, from Woolworths, Pitsi Mahoto. Welcome.
Hello, hello.
What are we making today?
We are making some smoked fish cakes. Mm-hmm. We have a Greek salad. We have a honey and truffle dressing. And we have a Mediterranean potato bake.
This is just my absolute ultimate. Mmm, this truffle olive oil, it's amazing. Okay, let's get starting. I don't even know how to make a smeared fish cake, so I'm guessing you're going to teach me how immediately.
Okay.
Okay, the first step is...
So, you're going to do the salsa verde mayonnaise, okay? Which is half a cup of the mayonnaise and a quarter cup of the salsa verde.
So just half of this?
Or the whole thing if you want to.
Okay, perfect. Cool. And all of that?
Yes.
Just mix it up?
Yes, and just mix it up. Cool. I'll do the salad this side.
There you go. And put all of this in. That smells good. And now what are you doing? Just making the salad?
I'm just making the salad, doing the fish cakes and some milk tart over there.
I love a ready-to-eat salad. And even if you don't just have it like that, it's always nice, well, considering all I really know how to make is salads. So even if you're just using the ready-to-eat one and you add little extras to it as well.
Yes, that's perfect. Actually, yes, you can do that.
This looks amazing. And smells really good. I can imagine that this would be quite a fantastic accompaniment to the fish.
Yes, yes. Salsa verde, I mean, with the salsa verde, you can make it however you want it to. I mean, you can just add a couple. There is class ingredients that you add to it, but any green ingredients that you have, you can just add it together and, you know, whatever taste you want to. Add some garlic in there, salt, pepper, and you're good to go.
Okay, I'm a whiz in the kitchen already. The salsa verde is complete. And now we have to do our salad dressing.
Yes, salad dressing, very, very simple. So we're going to add our honey.
It's quite a basic salad, so this dressing has to be quite amazing, though.
It is. It brings out all the flavors. Like you said before, you can make it however you want it. You know, salad dressing is literally just there to dress the salad. You know, add a little bit of extra flavor.
Yeah. So salt, pepper, honey.
Salt, pepper, honey, and a little bit of truffle oil.
Not so little. The more the merrier.
I see you love it a lot.
Oh, I really enjoy truffle oil.
I'm just going to mix it all up. This is actually part of the eat-in promotion that we have at Woolworths. So it's basically, the whole concept behind it is to, you know, it would be cheaper for you to eat in than it is to go out.
Okay.
But obviously, we want it to be exciting, we want it to be delicious.
Definitely.
You know, so what we have here is the milk tart.
Okay.
Beautiful design on here. And we're going to be serving that with raspberries and candied walnuts.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we're just getting the main course and the dessert sorted all at once.
Yes.
Okay,
quick and easy. Okay, and this is going to go in the oven at 160 for 8 minutes. This is going to go in the oven at 200 degrees. And do you want to dress the salad?
Sensational. Okay, so you added the truffle oil.
Yes.
And then was that vinegar you threw in?
White wine vinegar, yes.
But the dressing is just that extra
That little bit of tang that it adds and a little bit of sweetness as well. Truffle oil just bringing like such nice flavors.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you so much. I really like this. I might just eat in for a change. And if you're a fan of Elvis Presley, the king of rock and roll, then stay where you are, because after the break, we're taking a look at a dance tribute show called Private Presley, which was developed here in South Africa. We'll be right back.
Give kids the gift of hearing this Christmas. Are you with us?
Welcome back to the Afternoon Express Loft. Lovely to have you join us. Brought back to stage for its fourth season due to popular demand, Private Presley is a tribute of dance to the king of rock and roll, Elvis Presley. The show features more than 30 of Elvis's original recordings, and joining us on the couch is the man behind it all, award-winning director and choreographer Sean Bovin. Welcome to the Loft, Sean.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, lovely to have you. How did the idea to put on this kind of a show come up?
Well, you know, I studied ballet at UCT Dance School and then went on to a ballet career and was a principal dancer. But I always had a little bit of a flair to me. I was kind of known as the Johnny Vegas of ballet because I never really stuck to too many of the rules. I stuck to the technique, but I also had this kind of flair. And this came about because I've always had an interest in iconic singers. And because Elvis's music is so universal, it was an instant place to start. But it wasn't just his music, it's his story, and that's why it's called Private Presley, because it's a look into some of his private times in his life, as well as celebrating some of his timeless music. And of course, the most important is the world's most publicized romance with Priscilla Presley, and that took the world by storm. So using his music, I've basically gone from the 50s into the 60s, the rise of this rock and roll star, until, you know, his demise. But just before his demise, he performs in Vegas. It's still a feel-good show.
I mean, it's feel-good music. When you listen to Elvis Presley's music, you can't help but dance. But what is it about his music that speaks to you personally?
I think there's a balance, because he has these rock and roll numbers, the foot stamping, you know, like really energetic, high beat, high energy numbers. But he also has the most incredible ballads, like I Can't Help Falling in Love with You, Always on My Mind, the classics. And that's when it gets tricky to choreograph, because you need to nail it choreographically to do a timeless piece like Always on My Mind and the one that you're going to see today, Can't Help Falling in Love with You.
Right. Speaking of choreography, what kind of dance styles, or how many different dance styles do you incorporate into the show?
Well, I've always been known as a sort of a person that tries to mix styles. And although the dancers do a ballet class every day, it's strictly ballet class to start, so that their technique is on form. But then I fuse it. And obviously with this show, it's a fusion of ballet and rock and roll. But there's a lot of athleticism with the men. Especially in the army scene. That's why it's Private Presley as well, because we do go to the army base in Germany during this dance piece, and we see him there for 18 months, and that's where he meets Julia Prowse, and in fact, that's where he meets Priscilla as a 14 and a half year old girl. So any parents out of there would have had a nightmare that she was meeting the king of rock and roll.
Right, and just take us through the story without giving too much away for the audience.
It sort of plots him. Act one is set in the 50s and Act two is set in the 60s. And it starts with him and all his friends hanging out in a diner. And obviously him meeting several of his love affairs. Natalie Wood was one. And by the time you get to Act two, you have the woman that broke the whole relationship up, and that's Anne Margaret. And this is all based on fact. And woven into the story is this highly energetic 50s rock and roll on point for the girls. Shame, their feet are dying. Rock and roll on point. And for the men, it's one lift after another. So if you're not strong and you haven't been to gym that day, you ain't gonna get through the show.
Yeah, because I was about to ask you, I mean, planning and preparing for a show like this must be a rigorous process. What do the dancers go through?
I think it is rigorous. It's about 6 to 8 hours of rehearsal a day. But also, we've got the top talent in the country, performing in this. And I've obviously chosen people that have an extra special performance quality, as well as technique. Because I believe
that
it's like, I think it's a quadruple threat these days, because you have to sing, act, dance, and have an X Factor.
Wow.
I've collected some amazing, amazing dancers that dance for Boven Ballet. Mm-hmm. Amongst them are Henk Opperman and Kristen Wilson, who are playing the leads. Mm-hmm. And we have dancers like Devin Marshbank, who comes from a hip hop background. And
so
we have
cool.
a little bebop boy who does all the sort of narrating the whole way through in a dance style, but he's on roller skates and gymnastics, and so there's everything for everyone.
What is the chemistry like amongst the cast when the curtains are down? How does everybody get on?
It's a bit like a circus, I must be honest. We've grown quite close in the 7 years to become quite a big family.
7 years.
Yeah, it's been going for 7 years, although it's project-based.
Yes,
so,
of course.
But it's been interesting. And also, I mean, people grow fond of each other.
Yes.
And they form, like, bonds with each other. So sometimes on stage you're seeing some real love affairs.
Real love affairs.
I'm not saying any more than that.
Life imitating art there.
Exactly.
So you've brought along two of your principal dancers to entice us and give us a sneak preview of the show. Can you just take us through the performance?
Well, it's a piece from Act Two, and it's they're in Hollywood and about to get engaged, and it's called The Bench Duet, but it's from the classic I Can't Help Falling in Love with You, and obviously it's a love duet.
Yes.
And this is with Kristen playing Priscilla, and Henk Opperman playing Elvis.
Playing Elvis.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, without further ado, take it away, guys.
Wise men say only fools rush in, but I can't.
Absolutely extraordinary, guys.
Thank you so much.
Wow. Private Presley opened yesterday at the Baxter Theatre in Cape Town and runs until the 28th of November. Tickets are available at CompuTicket, and you can find more information on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. After the break, we're taking a look at the Queen tribute show called It's a Kind of Magic, and we're privileged to speak to Peter Freestone, the former PA and close friend of Freddie Mercury. Don't go away. Express
yourself. Clicks. Feel good. Pay less.
Welcome back. You're still watching Afternoon Express right here on SABC3. Now, Queen is arguably the greatest rock band of the 20th century. You'd struggle to find a person anywhere who doesn't know and love at least one of their iconic songs. Another One Bites the Dust, We Will Rock You, Bohemian Rhapsody. Now, these are just a few of the classics that have secured Queen a place in the history books. A tribute called It's a Kind of Magic sees four seasoned musicians take up the personas of the band and put on an epic night of rock at the Artscape in Cape Town. And join us on the couch as former PA and close friend of Freddie Mercury himself, Mr. Peter Freestone, who has given the show stamp of approval. Welcome to Afternoon Express. Lovely Hi. To have you in South Africa, Peter.
Thank you very much.
I'm
Thank
sure you. You get this question all the time. How was it working with Mr. Freddie Mercury, being so close to him and then ending up being one of his close friends?
Well, it was great fun. It was hard. Because the thing is, if you think about it, you never go to school to learn personal assistant. That just doesn't happen. So basically, the job was just living Freddie's life. You know, I did the day-to-day things that we all have to do, pay the bills, answer the door, pick up the telephone, all of those things, so he could concentrate on making music. We were friends. You have to be if you work together 24 hours a day. And it just worked. It just worked.
Absolutely. And if you've seen him performing, creating the music, but what was it about him and his character? He could capture thousands of people just from his charisma.
There was something very, very special about him. He could walk into a room, a crowded room, and as he walked in, all eyes would turn. There was just something, there was like an aura around him almost. He wasn't tall. He was 5'9", 175 centimetres.
You even know that?
I've had to work it out.
Yes.
But there was just something about him that he made all heads turn. And as you say, he could be performing. I mean, the biggest sort of single show that they ever did was Rock in Rio, year 85. And they performed in front of 250,000 people. But Freddie was able to make every single person think and feel that he was performing for them.
Yeah.
And that is the important thing. I mean, for a show like this, for Giles, he has to make every person in that audience think, he's there for me.
Absolutely. And talking about 1985, now Freddie and Queen, they performed a 20-minute set at the Live Aid concert at Wembley Stadium. A lot of people have been saying, to this day, that is the best live performance yet. Were you there? Do you remember that night?
Oh, I was there. I was there. And I can tell you the reason why. I think they were the only band on both sides of the Atlantic that actually rehearsed.
Wow.
For that 20-minute set, Queen spent 4 days in a theatre rehearsing. So many people, they're happy to do the charity shows, the big charity shows, but because it's their own music, they know what they're doing, they don't have to do anything, and they just go on and perform. But all, Freddie, Queen, all of them were perfectionists. Everything had to be exactly right. And the only way you can do that is rehearsing.
Absolutely. They always say the difference between ordinary is that little bit of extra, right? That
yes.
Yeah,
so, yeah.
Between extra and extraordinary.
And it's just that little bit.
Of effort.
That little bit that just makes it.
Absolutely. And then the rest of the band members, are you close to them? You know, did you have a relationship with them?
Yes.
How was
it being
around such legends?
Well, you see, the thing is, for me, it was actually quite easy because to me, they weren't legends.
You can't say that.
Yes, because the thing is, the people I used to work with were the likes of Pavarotti, Domingo, Montserrat Caballé, Margot Fonteyn, Rudolf Nureyev, Mikhail Baryshnikov. Those were the people that I used to work with before I started working with Queen.
It's incredible.
And if I was a huge fan of Queen, I could never have done the job. You would have spent your whole life just going, and nothing would happen. You'd be gone.
Yeah.
So what I found was, yes, they're amazing musicians. They are amazing writers of music, composers, and creators of the music. But they were also four wonderful human beings.
Absolutely. And another iconic, wonderful human being, and somebody that's that Freddie has worked with, of course, Michael Jackson.
Oh, yes.
Did you get to meet him?
Oh, yes. I played video games with him.
Really? How was he?
This was back in 1983.
Wow.
And Freddie and I went to the house in Encino. This was before he had Neverland and things. And because Freddie and Michael were just going to try and see what they could, if they could work together, what could happen. And we were, he took us on a tour around the house and everything around the little zoo and the gardens. And he had this huge room about the size of the loft here, full of video games. But again, you have to remember, it's not this sort of thing. This is click, click, click on this machine in front of you. And it was this sort of basketball tennis game. You know, you had a paddle that hit the ball. And we played that.
That is so fun. But unfortunately, you know, we have lost both Michael and Freddie, and you were with him until the very last moments. Can you share with us just the last couple of hours or days or weeks with him and what you remember?
I worked for Freddie for 12 years, and while he knew, we all knew, for the last 4 years of his life that he had a shortened life, nobody knew exactly how long he had, but it was only in the last 2 weeks that I actually saw a dying man. For as soon as Freddie knew and had confirmed that he had AIDS, he said, "We're not going to talk about this anymore. I have a life to live." He just wanted to make sure that what time he had left was used. The last time I actually spoke to him, you have to realize, for the last week of his life, he was never, ever alone. There were three of us who would look after him. We would do 8 hours, 8 hours, 8 hours. So there was someone with him 24 hours a day. I was with him on the Friday night after the statement was released that he had AIDS. And it was like a huge weight had been taken from his shoulders. He had been holding on, because he knew the world had to know that he had AIDS. Otherwise, if he died and it came out afterwards, it's like a dirty secret swept under the carpet. And he knew that he had to help make people aware that anybody can get this disease. It doesn't matter if you live in a mansion or you live on the streets. The disease doesn't care.
And I mean, being with him for 12 years, was there something in particular he wanted to be remembered for? Was there a legacy? Was there something he said, "You know, Peter, if I should go, this is what I want everybody, apart from the music"?
He never really thought of himself as that big. For him, he put two people on a pedestal. He put John Lennon and Elvis Presley on a pedestal. Those were the people he looked up to. He never dreamt that people would put him on that same level. For me, I think people have to remember that he loved laughing. He loved having fun. You know, nobody knows how long a life you have. I'm not saying you have to live every day as though it's your last. I'm just saying that you have to enjoy every day.
Absolutely. Well, earlier on, Peter, you did mention Giles Taylor, who plays Freddie Mercury in the brand new It's a Kind of Magic, which is a very epic, iconic tribute to, of course, Freddie Mercury and the band Queen. Now, we have him in the loft today. He plays the character Freddie Mercury, and he's here to give us a little sneak peek of what you can expect from the show. Check it out. Incredible. Lovely to finally meet you.
Likewise. Thank you.
Welcome to Afternoon Express. Welcome to A Lovely Love. Now, this the tribute band, how long have you been together and how many countries have you visited around the world?
This particular lineup has been together for about 2 years now. Mm-hmm. And we have been to more countries than I can remember. We've just finished a tour of America and Canada. I've just been over in Europe. Obviously, now we're here in South Africa. We're performing in Cape Town from the 11th to the 22nd of this month. Then we go to Durban for a month, and then Johannesburg, and then we're off to the Orient. So it's all go. It's
fantastic.
Good.
Well, welcome to South Africa. But, I mean, the pressure of, playing such an iconic person, such an iconic musician. Tell me a little bit more about the preparation and the research going into this particular tribute concert.
Ultimately, if you're going to fill the someone's shoes who is this big, then people are going to have very high expectations of what you're going to do, especially fans of that person. So Queen fans are going to be, of course, the most critical because they had so much love for Freddie. So in terms of preparation, you really have to have everything down. If I go on stage and pretend to be Freddie Mercury, then I have to sound like him. Mm-hmm. I, of course, have to look like him. But more importantly, I have to have the mannerisms like him as well. Absolutely. There's a lot of very good tribute acts out there who sing like the people they're trying to impersonate, but when they go on stage, don't behave or act as, you know, flamboyant or as reserved as they may be. So obviously I go on stage and I have to be effectively very camp, very commanding. A lot of time, just say nothing and, you know, take the presence and deal with it as necessary.
I love that you mentioned Queen's fans. If I'm a diehard Queen fan, why do I need to come see It's a Kind of Magic? And what can we expect at the Escape Theatre?
Well, if you're a diehard Queen fan, then you'd have loved listening to and seeing Queen with Freddie there. Mm. Freddie, as Peter has just said, sadly, you know, passed away in 1991. So effectively, this is as close as you're going to get to seeing Queen live as they were in their heyday.
Fantastic. Well, Darcy, thank you very, very much for coming and joining us in the loft. He smells so good. I wish you were right here with us in the loft. If you are in Cape Town, make sure that you check out It's a Kind of Magic, a very special tribute to, of course, all Queen's fans and to the incredible, iconic Queen band. And do remember that tickets are available at CompuTicket. And all our information is available on the website, afternoonexpress.co.za. After the break, Danilo heads on out to Joburg, Sun City. We catch up with him straight after the break. Express
yourself. Give kids the gift of hearing this Christmas. Are you with us?
Welcome back to Afternoon Express, and we're showing you just how easy it is to eat in. In fact, we've been able to make dinner and dessert in just a few simple minutes. So we're already ready to plate.
Yes.
This has been baking in the oven, that's been baking in the oven, and now we're almost complete.
Yes.
So let's start with the dinner first, and then we move on to
the dessert.
My favorite.
Okay, so what you're gonna do, just put this Mediterranean potato bake.
And are those sweet like potatoes that, or normal potatoes?
Just normal potatoes.
Okay, but you can do it for sweet potatoes as well.
Of course, you can do. You know, I always say that the recipe is just a guide. That's all it is. You know, you can always make it however you like it in your family. Some families like sweet potato, some don't, you know, so you can do it exactly how you want it to. Even with orange sweet potato, if you want a different color dimension, you can do that as well.
Fantastic.
Which is awesome. Okay, so we have our potato bake here.
Mm-hmm.
Just a bit of rosemary on top. Okay, and we have our salad here.
Mm. Okay, so we've got our fish cakes, our potatoes, our salad.
Yes.
That's it. We can just serve it like that.
Just like that. You know, with a bit of salsa verde on top, and people can dish as much as they want to.
Great. Yeah. Well, I'll dish like this, just for effect. I mean, how good does that look?
Yeah.
I really enjoy this because you're teaching me how to cook something at my cooking level that I can actually handle. So this is great.
Yes, this is meant to be quick, easy, convenient. You know, that's something Woolworths does really, really well, which is convenience.
Definitely. And then for dessert.
Yes.
Now, how do we do this?
So all we're going to do is, you know, just take these candied walnuts, break them up a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And how these were made was just, you take some sugar and a little bit of water and some of these candied walnuts, and you're going to cook it in the, you're going to make a sugar syrup and cook it in the sugar syrup.
Okay. Excellent.
Yeah, so you're just going to wait for the sugar syrup to get a bit brown, almost like maybe the tone of my skin. And with a sugar syrup or with a candy that you're going to make, you must be careful because it goes from perfect to burnt very, very quickly. So you must remove it just before.
You know what I love about this concept is that usually I would just serve this milk tart as is, like fresh out of the box. But I think it's so nice, like just putting a few berries together and a few little nuts together, that it really does make something ordinary extraordinary. Now, yes. Doesn't that look delicious? Now, we won't put the cream on just in case some of our guests don't want the cream with that. But that really looks magic. Thank you so much.
No problem.
Look,
no problem.
We did dinner and dessert in no time at all. Amazing. Thank you so much to you as well for joining us. Hope you cooked along with us. All you need to do is visit afternoonexpress.co.za for all of the recipes and, of course, the shopping list. Now, we've paid tribute to some real legends in the loft today, but Danilo traveled to Joburg this week to catch up with a living legend from home soil. Here's what he got up to.
The Black Knight, Mr. Fitness, and South Africa's most successful golfer ever, Gary Player celebrated his 80th birthday, and we're here to celebrate with him and his wife Vivian here at Sun City as he tries to raise 1 billion rand by 2020. So Viv and Mr. Player, it's an honor to be here today with you guys. First of all, congratulations on celebrating 80 years of an incredible life that you've lived. You must have learned many lessons over those years. What would you say is the one that you've kept close to your heart?
Well, first of all, when you travel extensively like I have, and representing my country with great joy, because I just love our people in South Africa, and Africa's in my heart. I think the word that comes to mind is gratitude. It's very important to be grateful for things in life, particularly when you think what a mess the world is in today. But what I've learned to help the young people, you've got to have faith. You've got to work hard. And you've got to have love in your heart.
Both of you are looking very fresh at the moment, but I believe you had an absolutely spectacular birthday gala yesterday, Gary.
Last night was a party. I mean, you really had to see this to believe it. We had the best bands, African, all kinds of music, and over 300 of my friends from all over the world. And, you know, I've been blessed when you think about it. To be a professional golfer for 63 years.
Vivian, Gary clearly hasn't lived up to his surname at all. He's not a player in any sense of the word. You met him when he was 14 years old. What has your journey been like following this great, great man?
Amazing life we've had, Dad, really. Very, very grateful for all that Gary has been able to achieve, for our health at this age, for our wonderful children, family, all of our grandchildren, who most of them are here this week. We've had a fairy tale life, really.
Gary, what has been the biggest lesson you think you've learned from Vivian over the years?
That's the big thing. This lady is a baobab tree. You know, baobab is the tree of all trees. She has spread her wings, and with our 22 grandchildren and 6 children. But above all, it'd be remiss of me not to say that I think one of the main reasons, besides the talent that was loaned to me, you cannot become a world champion if you don't have a wife like I've had, I can tell you.
Up until now, your Gary Player Invitational Series has raised over 800 million rand for charities around the world. Your hope is to raise a billion. Why is it that charity is so close to your heart?
One of the things that really excites me is that we go into the boondocks where young black children are lying there sick, and really the mothers are desperate. They don't know what to do. And we come in with a helicopter, a bus, a car, a taxi, and take them mainly in the Cape area, around that area, to a Gary Player Award in a hospital in Cape Town. And we save their lives. So we're doing some very interesting, different kinds of charity. And wherever we raise money, that money goes to that particular country. But obviously South Africa is my favorite. And when you go to a school like Blair Athol School, that school there, we've given them money that will last forever invested. That money will be there forever, and that school will continue forever. And to think that we're educating all these young black children, what a thrill for me to know that that is taking place.
We were in Cape Town, and let Gary tell the story, he does it so much better than I. We were in Cape Town, and some young black guys shouted from the top of a building, "Hey, Gary, I was at Blair Athol School, and now I'm doing well. I've had a great education, and I've got a great job." You know, just a little thing that came to my mind. Just so special that you can make a difference in someone's life.
Well, if I may elaborate on that. Here's this young black gentleman at the top of the building. I get quite tearful now when I think about it. And he says, "I love you, man." He says, "You changed my life. I went to university. I'm making cash, man. I got a job." I felt so choked. That is so rewarding, isn't it?
So I've seen the list of players that are coming to the Invitational Series. Who can we expect to be playing this weekend?
Brian McFadden, who's so popular, Ronan Keating, Graham Smith. He's playing.
And Aaron McQuinn is also coming, right?
McQuinn is coming, yes, and he was a tremendous soccer player, wasn't he? And then we got Thomas, Bad Boy Thomas, coming as well. He's a great MC. But above all, we've got not only these celebrities and golf players, we've got a lot of women pros. Because we've got to think of our young women in South Africa as well. So we want to try and have examples for people to see on the television. So it's going to be a very, very exciting event.
Well, Vivian and Gary, thank you so much for having us here today. I could honestly sit for hours and just absorb all this wisdom that has been your lives over the last few years. Thank you so much for all you do for our country and for the rest of the world.
Thank you, Dan. Enjoyed it.
Well, there you have it, South Africa. Gabbi Katz, internationally successful, famous and wealthy, yet he still remains so humble. It's an important message for both you and I to learn. Let's hope he reaches that goal of raising 1 billion rand in the future. Express
yourself. Groundbreaking treatment for acne. Fresh Pack. Goodness comes naturally.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. Now, what do the blue-haired Betty, Miss Honeybun Shortcake, Jenny Genocide, and Miss Penelope Peacock all have in common? Well, they will all be taking part in SA's first ever 50s retro pinup pageant, organised by Girls for Girls at the Dusty Rebels and the Bombshell Rockabilly Festival in Cape Town over the weekend. Sound interesting? Well, then maybe retro cool is just the thing for you. Chatting to the couch now is the gorgeous Gabbi Katz, otherwise known as the blue-haired Betty.
Thank you for having me, Jeannie.
Now, you are essentially South Africa's most successful pinup because you've won awards all over the world. I mean, what does that mean?
Thank you. Well, yes, I did. I competed earlier this year in the Miss Viva Las Vegas pinup pageant, which is hosted at the largest international rockabilly festival in the world, where I placed third. But other than that, I really just, this is who I am. It's not a job, it's not a hobby. This is who I am and this is how I look every day of the week.
I love it.
And I just love promoting the culture and what it stands for and just really getting more people locally involved.
Now, I mean, how big is it? What is the appeal to this 40s and 50s retro vibe? And I mean, are there a lot of followers?
Look, there's obviously a different scale if you're going to look internationally to locally, but it's a modern day culture, better known as rockabilly, and it is really inspired by the 40s and 50s lifestyle. So it goes back to the music, the cars, the look, the hair, the makeup, etc. So internationally, this has been very popular for many years now. Yeah. But as with South Africa, it always takes a bit of warming up. So it's only been the last 3 or 4 years now that this has really started taking off locally. And I do believe that the Dusty Rebels and the Bombshells Rockabilly Festival has played a big part in this. Because
definitely.
It's a big festival that really incorporates all the elements of the culture and brings it all together so people can experience the whole vibe and the whole lifestyle all in one place.
I'm definitely going to the festival. I can't wait. I
hope
think it's
so.
Going to be amazing.
Fabulous.
But it's so sexy to me, this whole look. Mm-hmm. I know you've brought a couple of models through who are going to be modelling
this. Yes, well, these are not just models. They are actual contestants in the Miss Bombshell Betty Pinup pageant.
Oh, I love.
And it is the first Pinup pageant to ever be hosted in South Africa. So this is Miss Honey Bun Shortcake,
Hi.
One of our top 10 finalists. And her look is really inspired by the 1950s very classic, you can say, imagine her going to the 1950s to the prom.
Yes.
In her beautiful dress, or out to tea with her friends. So it's the floral print, it's the light pastel colours. She has a nude fishnet on. Fishnets are also a key element.
Oh, I love a fishnet.
The little gloves. No, you know, girl in the 40s went out without her gloves. The pearl necklace, again, a very classic jewellery item. And then her hair is done in a barrel roll, which is, again, reminiscent of the 40s hairstyling.
It's absolutely beautiful. Okay, who do we have next?
Up next, I think we have Miss Jenny Genocide.
Oh, that is
And she
too
is
cute.
Very sweet and petite. Her dress, also the fit and flare shape, which is the silhouette of the 50s.
Yes.
She has the swallow motif on her dress, which is one of those iconic rockabilly motifs. You'd get certain motifs that are very true to the rockabilly culture, polka dots, anchors, and then also something like swallows. She's also wearing her gloves, and then she has a bandana tied around her head, which is also something that's inspired by the 40s and the World War II
it
era.
It reminds me of those girls who always
But that's
those
exactly where it comes
like,
from.
I'm strong.
That we can do it.
I love it, yes.
Yes.
This
that
is exactly the era that I should have been born in.
There we go, exactly. And then, last but not least, we have Penelope Peacock. And her dress is actually genuine vintage.
Oh,
it is an original
beautiful.
Vintage dress. Also, a prom dress. You can totally picture that rocking
Absolutely.
Up at the prom a couple of decades ago.
It reminds me of that movie, Back to the Future.
Exactly. If you imagine and also think about Greece.
Definitely.
And when they went to the prom, it's that whole look.
I
and then
it.
She also has genuine pearls that she's wearing, but then as the rockabilly culture, being a modern culture, you can kind of add some modern flair to it, and she's doing that with her out there shoes.
Great. Do we have any more? Girls, come over. I want to chat with all of you. And come and have a seat.
And join us.
You all look magnificent. Who are the judges? Because I think trying to find out who's the pageant queen is going to be quite a quite a feat.
Yes, we have a awesome panel of judges. We have 6 judges, and they all were selected for various reasons. People that are in the industry that understand the look and the culture. And we will be giving them set characteristics and things to look out for. It's not just about who has the prettiest face or the best body.
No,
a
but
lot
that's
more
what I like about
it.
You don't have to be a model or some gorgeous, I mean, and not that you don't all look like models and are incredibly gorgeous, but it is just so sexy. It's about such a unique style. So why did the three of you decide to get into this and pull it off so well?
Well, for me personally, I grew up with collectors for parents, so our house was filled with everything from the 20s to the 70s. So for me, it was quite a natural progression just to enter the pageant. And also, I can be quite shy, so it was something to get out of my comfort zone and get a little bit of confidence and get out there.
And for you, Jenny Genocide?
Well, for me, I've always sort of loved the classy, elegant look that came from the 40s and 50s, and I feel like in modern culture, we've lost like a lot of that. Like, the wearing of gloves these days is just very... For me, I've just always been obsessed with looking like an absolute lady, so...
Well, you are absolutely graceful. And for you?
For me, I've always just... I've seen this style in this era as a symbol of very powerful women taking control of themselves and stepping up and really saying, look at me, I am beautiful, I take care of myself, but I'm also strong, I'm not a waif. And that's
Excellent.
What works for me in this particular era and style.
And you girls dress like this every day. This is your style.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're quite committed to the look. I love it. I absolutely love it. Okay, so I believe you're all going to doll me up, and I'm going to come out in my little rockabilly Pinup outfit. I cannot wait for it! And if you are in the Western Cape area over the weekend and you want to attend SA's first Pinup pageant, you can catch these ladies at the Dusty Rebels and the Bombshell Rockabilly Festival tomorrow, the 14th of November, at the West Coast Ostrich Ranch on the N7, just outside Cape Town. And today we are giving away four sets of double tickets to four very lucky viewers. Simply SMS the keyword express, your name and city to 33728. SMSs cost R1.50 each, T's and C's apply, and are available on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. I'm going to be back in a little while, dressed up all up in my rockabilly and Bombshell outfit. Right now, though, over to Bonnie and Bonang.
Tonight is the season finale of Winner Home at 7:30 p.m. on SABC3.
Absolutely. What do the villas which the designer contestants decorated look like in their final form? What do the judges think? Who walks away as the best designer and wins that 100,000 rand check?
After 13 weeks of grueling challenges that have pushed the aspiring interior designers and their imaginations to the limit, it all comes down to this.
Absolutely. Also, if you've entered the viewers competition, then tonight is the night you do not want to miss, as they announce the three lucky winners. Third prize is 50,000 rands worth of LG products, allowing the winner to furnish their home with cutting-edge appliances. Second prize is that all-new Mercedes-Benz GLC 300.
Oh my gosh, what incredible prizes. And the first prize is that two-bedroom home at Ilala Views in Durban, set within the prestigious Ilala Ridge Estate.
Absolutely. Winner Home is proudly brought to you by Private Property in association with Nedbank.
Be sure to watch Winner Home, the Design Edition at 7:30 tonight to see which of our three contestants wins the 100,000 Rand prize as the season's winning interior designer.
Hi, my name is Jacqueline Timmer. I love jazz. I love playing soccer. When I'm alone, I love to dance. My design style is totally different. The way that I look at things is totally different. My colors are different. The way that I think of design is different. And I believe that South Africa needs something that is different. Winning this show would change my life, it would change my family's life, it would change this young little girl that thinks this is where I'm gonna end up. Winning this show would mean that you can come from any background and make something of yourself.
Hi, I'm Zunkita. I'm a lover of sunshine. One thing people don't know about me is that I think I can sing. And I know you'll be the best of me, the years... messed up the words. I want to be a designer because I get to express myself in a creative way. And this is a perfect opportunity to live that dream. I'm a quiet underdog. I can really surprise everyone. I glued my hand the other day. I glued my hand together. Who does that?
Hi, I'm Zanzi. My name is Fiso Shange, born and bred in Durban. I'm a crazy guy. I know that sounds a little bit crazy. I love my mom, I love my family, and I love design. It's in my soul, it's in my blood. I've got the love, I've got the passion for it. Design keeps me going. I'm always out there for new ideas. I blend that with who I am and where I come from. And with that, you get a new form of design, which is what the world is waiting for.
Watch tonight as we also announce the names of our six viewer finalists who stand a chance of winning one of three amazing prizes: innovative home appliances, a luxury car, and a two-bedroom home in Durban. It's all happening tonight, Friday the 13th at 7:30 on SABC3. That's Winner Home. Find it on 3.
Wow, what an incredible show we've had. And unfortunately, all good things come to an end, but they come back. And
absolutely.
Come back.
Somebody who has to come back, though, because she had a whole complete makeover, is Jay Dizzle. Look at you. Look at you. Look at you. You look really good, by the way. How do you feel?
You look absolutely gorgeous.
I feel like I was actually born to be part of this generation. Now, you know, part of the girls, the Pinups and the Rockabillys,
yeah.
They all don't ever have their own names. They've all got, like, these amazing, like, Blueberry and... Mm-hmm.
And what's yours?
Cupcake Candy. Well, I don't know. I was thinking the two of you could give me one.
Jay Dizzle.
Yeah, or Jay what Dizzle. About Mark? Tart Mama.
Milk Tart Mama.
Yeah, I like that. I like that.
You know, I slept for hours to make it that milk tart.
You belong on the cover of Good Housekeeping, dressed like that, and making food like
yeah,
this.
Yeah.
So dish up for us while you're at it, milk tart, Jeannie.
I'm a proper Stepford wife.
Yeah!
All the men can, you know, send us through their CVs on our website, right?
Mm-hmm. But make sure you join us again on Monday for Afternoon Express and tune in early, because during the first 15 minutes of the show, we'll be chatting to Ron Rutland, a man who cycled for 2 years through Africa and Europe to make it to London in time for the Rugby World Cup. You don't want to miss that.
Absolutely. We've got all of that and this and, I mean, can we eat? I'm really
starving. We can definitely eat. The beautiful thing about this era was that you could have eaten anything. Nobody's going to see your hips.
Absolutely.
Let's tuck in.
I'm going to eat.
Go for it. And alrighty. A huge thank you for all of our guests today. It was absolutely awesome. And we'll be back on Monday. For now, though, ciao and happy eating.
Next week on Afternoon Express, we chat to the man who cycled to the Rugby World Cup. Seven Delan's Anna van Biljon cooks us something special. Artist and activist Nomsa Mazwai gives us an exclusive performance. And Chris Chameleon shares his brand new children's book.
Another feel-good production.
Hi, YouTubers. Thank you so much for watching the show. Be sure to not miss another episode by clicking subscribe right over there. And we'll see you every day. Afternoon Express. Enjoy.